Show presented by eDragonTees.com for all your printing needs, banners, t-shirts, race shirts. eDragonTees.com is the one to go to. You're getting your team ready for Beach to Bay. You're getting your team ready for Capital Coast Relay. Look far further than eDragonTees.com.
Got spaghetti and a cheap bottle of wine. Don't need no concert in the city. I got a stereo and the best of Patsy Cline. Ain't got no caviar, no Dom Perignon. But as far as I can see, I got everything I want. Cause I got a roof over my head, the woman I love.
Oh, yeah, ladies and gentlemen, it's that time of the week. Welcome, welcome, welcome. It's Mark from iSpeakForYou.net. I got the coaches in today. And, of course, we're going to have them in a little bit. And of course, the subjects, we put it all over Facebook. I don't know if we put it on Twitter or not. But we got Capital of the Coast update at 12 o'clock. Mr. Clint be calling in. And then we're going to talk about that incredible relay. It's a 223-mile relay from Austin, Texas, all the way to the beautiful beach of Corpus Christi. And then we got the coaches' topics. How do we grow our sport? Digging deep. To finish, we got some incredible stories about that. Are rest days really that necessary? As I got Coach Mac right here looking over stuff. Hydration and gelling during training and races. Is that really important? Not according to Runner's World. We'll be right back with that, of course. And then we're going to have the Coach's Corner with SanAntonioTriathlete.com. That's Coach Mac Williams. JenRulon.com, of course, JenRulon. And GaryBremer.com. They'll be answering questions from yourself, clients, whoever. If you got questions for them, that is the way to do it. And then, of course, we're going to have closing words and we got giveaways. We're going to give away an entry, two entries to the Dragon's Den Half Marathon and Relay. And, of course, we're starting off, and there is Mr. Clint right there. Hello, Clint. How are you, sir?
I'm doing good, Mark. How you doing?
I'm doing awesome. So how's the weather over there in Hawaii? You got the surfboard out?
You know what? Right now, if you look here, you think, wow, it's absolutely gorgeous. It's there's not a breeze blowing, and it's crystal clear skies, and it's great. So get with me in about about 12 hours. We'll see what happens. But right now, it looks great.
Yeah, of course, you know, we're watching on the news and everything. In Hawaii, he's talking about, oh, there's no water in the stores or there's no water in HEB. Of course, everybody knows there's no HEBs in Hawaii. However, I mean, that obviously, certainly, that's the Big Island and maybe Lanai and everything. But how was it in Maui? Are you seeing that kind of strife and despair?
Yeah, you know, it's funny. They usually all the water's gone. All the canned foods are gone. They're telling everybody to sort of stock up for 7 days because that's how long it takes to get goods back to the island. So 7 days is sort of what they tell everybody to prepare for. But, it's hard to know because a lot of times there's so many false alarms, so a lot of people are thinking it's not going to be anything. But then again, they've only had three hurricanes hit Hawaii in the last 70 years, and now they're getting two in 1 week. So it's... they don't know what to expect, so everybody's a little not sure what to think. But Maui's definitely going to get a lot of rain and wind for sure. They know that. It's just hopefully it's not too damaging.
Well, I tell you what, we don't have to worry about those hurricanes over here down in South Texas at this point. I mean, obviously we have, but Capital to Coast Relay, the fifth annual, coming up 17-18 October. I know folks that are online, they're listening and everything right now. So, how are registrations going to kick it off?
Registrations are going great. Right now, we've already got over 50 teams that have confirmed and paid, and we've got 28 teams that have said, hold us a spot, we're registering. So, you know, we're thinking that we might reach our cap of 100 teams. So that's terrific. That's more than we've ever had, which is great. And we're really excited with the numbers this year. It's going to be fun. It's going to be a great, great time.
Now, of course, there's a question out there. What do you eat for 38 hours? And I don't know anybody who can eat 38 hours straight. Maybe Gary Brimmer or Mac Williams, one of those guys. But what do you eat? And you've done a lot of relays, Hood to Coast, obviously, those things. What does your team take out there to eat on the road while you're going? I mean, I know you're not going through Whataburger or any of that fun stuff.
Yeah, you know, I usually try to find just some snacks because you don't want to have a full belly, you know, when you're doing those long runs. So I usually just try to find some granola bars, some power bars, things like that to sort of help keep my stomach a little calm. But I usually don't eat too much. And then we usually have one good satisfying meal. You can only eat those power bars for so long. And you usually stop and you get some actual food. In your plate, you guys, after your vans have handed off, you find you've got about 5-6 hours to rest a little bit, so you go find a nice restaurant and get a good meal in.
Yeah, of course, we're going to talk to the coaches after we hang up with you and stuff about that kind of thing, because you know, sometimes those power bars or those nutrition bars that your fans eating, and of course we've always preached, don't do what you're going to do on race day that you have not done in training. You know, some of those folks are going to eat those power bars and think, oh, this could be good. You know, I've seen it. I've seen the commercials. I know Meb won Boston just on power bars, that kind of thing. I know. He's a UCAN guy. I'm just making an exception. So, of course, I got UCAN representatives sitting here about to slap me. But I'm just saying people believe the hype on certain things. And they'll go, oh, you know, these guys have won Ironman just eating power bar alone. They didn't do anything else. But if you have never eaten a power bar in training, you got to do what you're going to do in training. Don't do it on race day. So when these folks get in their vans, they really need to take their own meals of what they've had.
Exactly. No, that's so true. Because if your stomach's not used to it, and, last thing you want is an upset stomach in the middle of nowhere, Texas, there's not a lot of help for you there. So you want to make sure, you're doing what your body's used to, for sure. Yeah. Especially like with some of those goo packs and some of that's just stuff to stomach anyway, but some of the different things that people will take, I've done the goo before, and you get an instant shot of energy, but it's tough to swallow some of those things. But you're right. Whatever you've done in practice, in your training runs, that's what you should do when you're running in the race.
Now, right there, now at this point, like you say, we're probably going to max out and hit our 100-team limit. What should the teams be doing right now? I talked to a young man last night. Mac Williams is sitting here with us. His mic's not on right now, of course, but at his swim practice last night, one of the young men was talking about, yeah, we can get a team of six together. We're trying to figure out how we were going to get that. So right now, if there's folks that have not registered or have a team together, what should they be doing at this point with so we're not that far away from the race?
As far as training, you know, what they should try and do now is just get some intervals in. You start getting some shorter runs and then mix it in with some longer runs on the weekend. But as you get closer to race day, you're going to want to try and the biggest thing is to vary up your runs during the time of the day that you normally wouldn't run. So you'll run like at 6 in the morning and then run again at 2 in the afternoon and then set your alarm and get up and run it.
Whoa. You just said run at 2 in the afternoon. Do you know how hot it is in South Texas at this point at 2 in the afternoon?
I know.
You're right, though, because they're running at different times. I know Michelle, I mean, she's run the Capital Coast a couple of times, and she would get up at 3 in the morning to go do that 3 o'clock in the morning leg, so she knows what to expect. So that's one of those things.
Exactly.
Don't run during the day, because if you have a night leg, you need to know how to run in the middle of the darkness.
Yeah, some people, they've never run at night, and it just sometimes it's just unnerving, and it's a little scary, and it's sometimes it's just creepy because there's nobody there. But yeah, you need to definitely get your body used to running at different times of the day. That's the biggest challenge that most people will see is that they don't know what it's like to run in the middle of the night and then get up again, have much sleep, and then run again in the morning. And that's the biggest challenge.
And it's amazing. And I know Run with Robert, one of our favorite runners, of course, on the crew with Capital of the Coast. He did a seminar over in Houston. What could people take from that, and what can people pick off the brains of the veterans who have run this for the last 4 years?
Well, a lot of it's just what to expect. If you've never done a relay before, you're not sure what to expect. And I tell you what, Robert is, I'm actually on his team. It's funny, we switched directions or roles. He's my team captain when I run the other GCR relay, and so prepared. He's got everybody's legs written out and printed up, and he's got the budgets all set. He's got everything done. If you're not used to doing a relay or haven't done one before, by all means, he can send you his little checklist spreadsheet. It gives you everything you'll need as a captain or as a team leader to get prepared for the race. Everything as far as when you're picking up runners, when it happens, you know, make sure you have all your gear, make sure everybody's got hotel rooms, all the things that most people just don't even worry about. They just show up and run, and the team captain's the guy that sort of left, you know, putting all the rest of that together. So he's got a lot of good info.
Of course, you know, you want to make sure you guys have reflective gear, and make sure you have lights, all those kind of things. And obviously your van marking kit for the shenanigans that goes on. But it's really one of those things like it's a fun event. You know, obviously take it serious because it is a serious event. You know, people could get hurt. I don't want to be that kind of guy, but, you know, people can't get hurt about it. So take it serious. But also, it's so fun. Everybody has so much fun when they've done it. Like I said, this is the fifth year is just getting bigger and bigger and better. And we're looking forward to it. We cannot wait for it.
That's all. I'm excited too. And yeah, every year we just keep, knock on wood. We've never had any serious injuries. And so we just want to keep sure that we keep talking to people about making sure with their reflective gear and then trying to up that each year and trying to up what we're able to do for the runners along the way. But yeah, every year, as long as people are safe and have a good time, that's what we want.
So amazing. So of course, Clint, how do people get a hold of you? And the website, of course, is CapitalToCoastRelay.com. But how do people get a hold of you?
If you need to get a hold of me, you can just call or email Clint, and that's Clint at CapitalToCoastRelay.com. Or you can just go ahead and shoot me a text or a call at my cell phone, which is 206-817-6859.
So, of course, folks, if you have any questions about Capital of the Coast, you can email Clint or email myself. That's MP or info at ispeakforyou.net. MP at ispeakforyou.net or info at ispeakforyou.net will get me. And we'll get those questions and those answers out to you. Obviously, you can go on Facebook and answer those questions as well. There's a lot of good things on the website. A lot of questions you may have are very been asked. Look at photos from the previous years. One of the things we always tell people, bring sunscreen and bring rain gear, because you never know. It may rain on you for 30 minutes and it'd be hot the next 4 hours of your leg. But it's just one of those things. You never know what's going to happen. Just be prepared, and obviously be prepared for some fun. And every week we're going to talk about Cowboy of the Coast to kick off our show here. So, folks, if you want to know anything about that race, in my eyes, and Clint can't say it, but it is the best relay to run ever in the world. So, and he has a lot of friends.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, and you have a lot of friends that put on races. I'm used to Hooded Coast and all those fun things. But it's one of those things, like, I love this race. I've been there since day one, and I couldn't imagine not being at Cowboy of the Coast Relay at any point. This is so much fun.
Absolutely. We don't do it without you, so we really appreciate you and all you've done for the race as well. So.
Tell you what, folks, get five of your friends together, get your neighbors, and sign up for Cowboy Coast Relay. Now, Clint, I had a question. Really, we had someone that has texted in. What is the age requirement? How young can you be?
18.
Must be 18. Okay.
Yeah. Well, and if you're less than 18, we can work with you. If you've got an adult, you know, with supervision and stuff like that. If you've got a high school kid, we'll work with you, but for the most part, we just want to make sure that adults that are running down the middle of the highway and country roads in the middle of the night, that we're making sure they're safe.
There you go, folks. Again, that's one of those things, because I know folks that have, you know, super speedster, 15, 16-year-old, you know, state champions that would love to run this. But again, 18, must be adult for the safety reasons and everything. But again, Clint, thanks for calling in, and be safe over there in Hawaii, my friend.
All right, thanks, buddy.
All right, we'll talk to you soon. All right, bye-bye. Yeah, this is Mark with IceBeefy.net. Got the coaches. They've all come in. Got the NBA champions hat. Gary looks like he's been on Duck Dynasty the last 20 minutes. Got the Shiner bot. He looks like he's been hunting. I'm scared right now. But we'll be right back, ladies and gentlemen.
Addicted to the drama, only attracted to things that bring the trauma. Overseas, yeah, we trying to stop terrorism, but we still got terrorists here living in the USA, the big CIA, the Bloods and the Crips and the KKK. But if you only have love for your own race, then you only leave space to discriminate, and to discriminate only generates hate, and when you hate, then you're bound to get irate. Yeah, madness is what you demonstrate, and that's exactly how anger works and operates. Man, you gotta have love just to set it straight. Take control of your mind and meditate. Let your soul gravitate to the love, y'all, y'all.
People killing, people dying, children hurt and you hear them crying. Can you practice what you preach? And would you turn the other cheek? Father, 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 help us. Send some guidance from above. These people got me questioning.
Thursday's Races and Events is presented by eDragonTees.com, the premier company for your t-shirts, your banners, hats, flyers, embroidery, web design, and yes, even your koozies for your beverages. Online at eDragonTees.com. That's eDragonTees.com. Oh yeah, come on home. CyclingSwami.com. Professional bike fits. Custom footbeds, group rides, events, custom cycling clothing by Passe. Your Italian cycling outfitter from helmets and sunglasses by Solise. Get your SAG support for your next team or group ride and the world famous Ask Swami. Look for a coach, look no further. Easy to find and even a greater friend to our cycling family. Come on home to CyclingSwami.com.
Were you aware? Texas has a law that commercial vehicles, when passing a road user such as a cyclist, runner, or walker, must obey a 6 feet distance between said vehicle and the road user. Texas also has a law that all vehicles, when passing a road user, must obey a 3 feet distance. Can you see me now? 3 feet, 6 feet. It's the law.
Okay.
And we are live. It's the coaches.
That's our cue to be quiet.
I got the coaches in here. And, of course, the coaches are all wearing hats. They don't want to mess up their beautiful hair. Or they've already worked out today and their hair is just atrocious.
I just haven't showered.
Ooh.
I'm glad you're on the other side. Of the table. Glad you're on the other side of the table.
I gotta go swim, so it matters.
Today's
a little.
Yeah.
Geez,
today's my day off. I don't have to work out. I decided Thursday.
What, day off? Why would you do that?
We're gonna talk about that. We are going to talk about that. Because my playground is very hilly. There are no flat roads around where I live. So as soon as I go out, it's down or up. Even going down Redland Road, mm-hmm. when you go left, it's down. Or you go right, it's up. I mean, so you're gonna hit hills around here.
I always say in racing, what goes down will come up.
Yeah, people are like, oh, I love running downhill. I'll tell you, I mean, we all know, running downhill hurts. Mm-hmm. It'll hurt you worse than running uphill. Gary.
I know.
Gary looks like Doug Dynasty, man. He's going for the beard over here. But, of course, folks, this is iSpeedFree.net. I got the coaches in. Of course, we're going to talk about the topics right now, growing the sport, digging deep to finish. We got some incredible stories about that. Are rest days really necessary? Really? And, of course, hydration and gelling during training and running, because is it really necessary to hydrate while you're running? Runner's World doesn't seem to think so. So let you know.
I saw that.
Did you look that up?
I read that article. That. Mm-hmm. So let you know. So coaches, let's dig into it. How do we grow our sport real quick? Gary, of course, I got Gary Bremer from GaryBremer.com. I know people are Googling it right now or just going online looking at GaryBremer.com. You don't have to Google it.
Google me.
Google me. There you go. Hashtag Google me. And, of course, I got the Jen Rulon, as Mac and I like to say, the Jen Rulon. JenRulon.com over here in her sport or Spurs gear.
When you say that.
There you go. And, of course, Mac Williams, the swim coach of all coaches right there. Michelle looks like a pro in the water right
now.
She
does. She's doing good.
I asked her last night, I go, how come you didn't swim over everybody? Well, that wouldn't be nice. I go, they do that to you in the triathlon. He put everybody in one lane and told them to go. Oh, and they all looked at each other for a minute going, what? And he's like, go, go. And then they all like, oh.
You first.
And I said, go. Yeah,
I know.
And they find, oh, he really means this. And I'm like, get out of here.
And I was like, I go, Michelle, they'll crawl over you in a triathlon.
Yes, they will.
She's like, well, that's not nice.
They'll
I go,
pull
they're
your
not
legs.
Nice. Yeah, they'll knock your goggles off. I mean, all kinds of stuff.
Off.
Have you ever had that happen?
Knock your the goggles? Goggles?
She's too fast.
No. That's true.
She's way too fast. Yeah.
She's between the pros and the head of the first group of AG right. men's, right? There's that's Rulon right. out there by herself
right.
kicking butt.
She's already at the first buoy going,
yeah.
Really?
Where's everybody?
There's people 100 meters from the shore, and I'm
you
still
call
over
this
here.
A race?
It's crazy.
I just call the whales over and... and then just ride them.
Ah, there that's we what go. It is. Yeah, that's right.
Let you know, Jen used to work at SeaWorld. She's got that experience.
That's her secret.
So how do we grow our sport, Gary? How do we grow running?
Well, you know, I come into the sport with a pretty strong youth coaching background. I think the youth is a... Developing our youth is a good way to grow the sport. The sport itself of running... is doing fine. It is growing every year with women's running being continually to be the fastest growing gender side of the sport.
True.
Half marathon is the most popular distance, and women, I want to say, just off the top of my head, make up 62-65% of
wow.
the population. I see that from the sales point of view, from working at the expos, we get the breakdown, and women are by far outnumber the men. So,
and that's at every event too. I mean, I see that in the participants. I'm going, hey, guy, if you're a single guy and you're looking for a young lady or something, start running, start cycling, start triathlon, because you'll meet one.
It's true.
I mean, you know, another side of that, running and triathlon has caused divorces.
Yes,
mm-hmm.
I will say that.
Yeah,
because of. Jealous mates. Everybody's looking around at each other.
Well, that was
not
our,
you guys.
That was our off-air discussion.
Yeah, not right. not you guys, but you know, right. some guys are like. And Michelle and I had this topic, and I love Jen to kick in on this, and of course, Mac and yourself. But she's like, "Well, how am I going to do family time? Come home from work, spend time with the family, and still train?" I go, "That's one of our biggest dilemmas.
Yep.
Because we all love our families. We all want to spend time with our families. But if you're pursuing an Ironman or a Boston Marathon or something as your race." You're going to spend a lot of time away from your family.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And you're going to feel guilty about it. You know, and then they're going to start, I mean, I don't know. It's just my personal opinion.
No, you're right.
You know, they're going to start alienating. Oh, well, yeah, you're going to go train. You know, don't
Again.
Think about us. Yeah. And it's one of those things like, okay, but you knew I wanted to do this. You told me you would
support
yeah. but there's still a lot of animosity there.
And that's why I married a triathlete. you know, because I did date the people that were not triathletes or not Ironman athletes, and they just didn't understand.
It's not because Chris is hot. It's just because he's a triathlete.
Yeah. He is hot.
But then I think there are some people, and I've seen this, that they've started training for Boston or, you know, that's their goal or doing an Ironman, and but they've already been married, and now they're doing it, and that's very hard. That's where I see a lot of issues.
But I've seen both sides of this.
Yeah.
I've seen the non-runner and the runner bump heads when with the training. And then I've seen the runner-runner couples, and one couple gets jealous over the success of the other one.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Yep.
And it was very prevalent in some elite runners in the 90s.
Saw that with pro triathletes.
Yes, they mm-hmm. one all of a sudden has some breakthroughs and the other one struggles. I know an Olympic trials qualifier. She's qualified for two Olympic trials. Her husband was a very good age grouper. She started out as a very good age grouper, and all of a sudden she got better, and he constantly, in her last build up to the trials, complained about how he never had the opportunity that she had. It was much harder for guys, and that caused problems, a rift in their relationship. It really did in their marriage, and they really had to work hard.
There are surgeries to correct that.
Yeah. The divorce surgery.
But no, I used to say that too when I was a cat, you know, cat two cyclist racing his pros and stuff. I go, man, if I was a female, I'd be sponsored and all kinds of stuff, you know. But and then I would go race from some of the pro ladies and ride with them, and I'm going, oh hell no, they ride too fast.
I think the opportunities for sponsorship for any sport are actually equal. I just think that age groupers. Some age groupers who can get sponsored don't. They have a leg up on getting their foot in the door for a sponsorship. Some people don't know how to get sponsored. Mm-hmm. I know of people who are nowhere near Olympic trials qualifying and have a shoe sponsorship. A clothing sponsorship, but it's because shoe companies and sponsor companies, you know, and running especially, companies aren't necessarily looking for a world beater. They want somebody who can market.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I tell my runners all the time, get a blog, get a Twitter, and start talking about your products. I know two ladies in New York City who have never broken 3 hours, and they each have a shoe contract. They each have a nutrition contract.
Oh, yeah, I know those. I know.
They're all getting their free gear stuff because they are all over social media, and they talk about products, and companies mm-hmm. love that. So sponsorships are just as easy.
I was actually, this was a while back, but I was actually told by a coach, you know, I told him my Ironman Wisconsin time, and it was my first Ironman. It was under 13 hours, but I had all these sponsors, and he goes, "You're not fast enough to be sponsored." And
oh my goodness,
yeah,
I was livid, yeah. And I see that I see his name still, and I have no respect.
Oh hell, when I was 15 racing bicycles, I was. No means fast.
Did you say tricycles?
He said tricycles.
Yeah. Oh, I thought so.
Tricycles. Oh. Tricycles. It was a big wheel, actually. Oh, okay. It was a big wheel. Yeah. But no, I had bike stores that gave me a bike. They're like, yeah. we want to sponsor you. Here's a bike. And I went, dude, I can't even beat my local 5-year-old on their big wheel. No, no, no. But you're out there. Mm-hmm. We want you, you know, to go out there on our bike. So
I almost wanted to say, I'm like, and I have a personality and you don't. That's why I have a sponsor.
Right.
That's why she hit that on the nose.
That's it right there.
Absolutely.
And Chris Carmichael was actually Lance Armstrong's coach.
Yep.
Yeah, right. Anyway, so obviously we're going to talk about, we can go on for hours. Right. We can go on for hours about that subject. But, of course, we can talk about digging deep for a finish because there's so many folks at Ironman Boulder, and you've seen it yourself, Gary. You went through this at Boston this year. You know, there's so many folks that are doing these events for a reason. For battling cancer, you know, for a family member that they're doing, you know, in memorial of, for themselves, to get themselves better. But there's also, when they get to that marker or they get to that wall, mile 20 or whatever that wall is, or wherever that wall is, that they're like, I can't do this. I cannot make this finish line. But something clicks that goes, go, and you can make it. How deep have you dug, Gary, and we're going to go around the table, how deep have you dug to make a finish line when you thought there's no way in the world I'm going to make it?
I don't think I've ever gotten to a point where I didn't think I could finish I guess Boston this year was about as close. I mean, I was going to drop out, and true story, the reason I didn't drop out is because I bought the friggin' jacket. I've never bought the Boston jacket, and I bought it this year.
There you go.
And I had 11 and a half
Everybody
miles.
Has their own motivation.
And I should have dropped out. Yeah. I really should have, because it caused me some health issues this spring, and it still caused me some issues because I twisted my knee. And I've always said that if you injure yourself, you need to drop out. That's when you drop out. There's no shame in DNFing if you're hurt. There's no shame in DNFing, period. In the ultra world, they tell you you don't have to drop out unless you're injured. You just sit down and eat at the next aid station and wait, and you'll recover, and you can get up and finish. So that's, you know, that was, I had to dig pretty deep to keep moving at Boston this year. The downside to that is I dehydrated myself. I was probably a little dehydrated coming into Boston. It led to some emergency room visits 3 weeks later. Wow. Thought I was having some cardiac issues.
Wow, 3 weeks after Boston.
Yes.
Wow.
I thought I was having some cardiac issues. It was chronic dehydration.
Wow.
I was having some vasal reaction. I would sniff, and my veins were so I was so dehydrated that some of my veins in my heart were actually collapsing.
Wow.
And I was having some lightheadedness and passing out. So big lesson learned. Probably the deepest I ever dug in a race was that America's Finest City Half Marathon back in 92 or 93. Still my PR. Big climb to the finish, and I hammered the climb. And when I finished, I barely remember the last 200 meters. And when I finished, I collapsed and I came to. My wife was there, my mother-in-law was there, and the doctor was looking at me, deciding whether or not to start an IV on me. And they did. They started an IV, covered me with towels. That was probably the deepest I ever dug, and I didn't like it. And I don't think I've ever dug that deep in a race since then. So that's about it.
And I've got a great question. Once all three of you answered this question, but I've got a great question is, think about this, of course, is when should you just say, hey, this is, it's too much, but go ahead, generalon.com.
I mean, mine was just recently, and we talked briefly about it a couple of weeks ago, was Ironman Coeur d'Alene. You know, I was out on the swim. The waves were just hitting my face every time. Couldn't breathe, sort of panicked, and just was like, okay, HTFU. You know, right. Just get going. So I knew if once I got out of the swim, I would be fine. The bike is good. The winds were tough. And then the run, that's where you really have to dig deep. And I think, in the swim, I thought, okay, do I need to pull myself out? I can't breathe. But then, no, I drove all this way and we came all this way and I didn't want to. You know, in my mind, I was like, I don't want to disappoint myself. Right. I don't want to. I think DNFing can be a much harder mental thing when you actually do it, because you almost go into a depressed state. Mm. You see a lot of pros will actually gut it out and will do the race and finish the race because of that reason. I remember Tim DeBoom talking about that.
Yeah, but you don't see the after effect either. Like 3 weeks after
right,
Gary finished
right.
Boston, he was still having issues.
Right.
Even today, he's still having a little bit of issues. But the thing is you don't see the after effect. Like folks watch Kona and they're going, oh man, this pro did great. They're top 10. But you don't see them in the IV tent
yeah.
for 3 hours afterwards yeah. and you know stuff like that.
And you have to think about, like, is it a mental thing that you're having issues with? Or is it an injury, you know? Because, if you should pull out if you are having that injury, like, you know, Gary said. But is it that little demon in your head going, what are you doing? You're stupid. Why are you doing this? This
right.
is so dumb, you know? Anyways, but I, definitely at mile 24 at Ironman Coeur d'Alene, I actually took my my key that I have in my brain and I went click. I turned it off. Because that was the only thing that would get me through. I didn't want to think. I didn't want to do. I just had to go. And I pushed it the last 2 miles. So you just, and I think that comes in with training too.
Yeah.
I mean, you have to, you know, those runs on the track, those little mini workouts that I have people do, those 10-minute gut gas guzzlers workouts, you know, those things will help you get through that last 2 miles.
Oh, yeah. SanAntonioTriathlete.com.
Just to kind of piggyback on what Jen, before I get to say this, is, you know, a lot of it does have to do with the training, is because you're going to race how you train, and that's just kind of how it comes down to it. You got to get to a point, whether it's with micro workouts or you're going on long runs, really, how far can you go before your brain starts to go, hey, you're killing us, you need to quit, you know? And then at that point, it's a gut check, like she was talking about, you know, that key. What key is it? Because his key's different than mine, hers is different, you know, everybody has their own key, and you have to know what that is. And then when you get to that point, you got to know how to tough it out. The other thing too is willpower. You know, how much willpower do you have? So, and that comes down to training as well. Is, you know, if you know you're prepared, if you are prepared very well for a race, you don't need that much willpower in the beginning. Okay, so the more willpower you use at the beginning, that's the less you're going to have when you've got the 2 miles to kick in and finish that race. Yeah. So you kind of have to know your limitations and physically and mentally, and how far can you go mentally. And for me, when I've run one marathon, and it was 20 miles, that's when I hit my wall. And, you know, and I did one training race for the marathon. I trained for Austin, and then I took 3 weeks off. I ran 20 miles on a Sunday, and then the next week I ran the marathon. And I was like, I had no idea what I was getting myself into. I was like, well, I'm going to go run 20 miles and see what it feels like. And, you know, I can run all day, you know, as long as it's a decent pace. You know, I'm not a fast runner, but I can run long because I knew I could do it. But then, man, I hit that 20 miles, like, 2 10-miles, okay, 10 miles here, no big deal. I can do that any day. Then 10 more miles, I'll knock it out, I'll deal with it. And I was like, just 6 more miles.
Right.
Brother. Mile 20, absolutely, man. That's where it gets deep. And that last 6 miles was the longest 6 miles of my life, and I ran on pure will because I had nothing left at that point. I couldn't even feel my daggum legs, you know. And so that last mile was brutal, and I was like, oh, my gosh, this is really happening, you know. So
it's amazing because there was so many – I mean, obviously Ironman Boulder just happened, and, you know, Linda Stewart, Jennifer, a lot of the folks that did it, they dug deep to finish because they're like, oh, it was hot. It was in South Texas hot, but the altitude got them. You know, and Linda goes, that was probably one of the worst runs I've ever had, but I had to dig to finish it. Janet Brode, I mean, we're going to have her on Wednesday night. Yeah. Wednesday night, we're doing a special Ironman Boulder show at Juicer Heroes in Stone Oak.
Very
at
cool.
8 o'clock. And Janet was at 17:15. Yep. She was you know, over the cutoff, and she goes, you know what?
Exactly right.
Because you have to be under 17 hours for Ironman. But she was at 17:15, and she goes, there was no way I was going to stop. You know, because she knew, as long as she forward momentum, you know, as Gary's talked about before, you keep moving forward, you're going to get somewhere. Man. You know, and that's one of those things, like, as an announcer, and I know Mike goes through the same thing, hates doing the countdown and going, that's it. Mm-hmm. Everybody else is not going to be in the results. Even though we know you're coming, we can't do anything about it. Exactly right. So
Janet and I talked just yesterday, and she's just motivated.
Yeah.
She's on fire. She's like, okay, I want to start doing strength. What do I need to do? I need to drop the weight, blah, blah, blah. Like, I'm like, booyah. This is what you needed to make yourself better. And that's what I love about Ironman.
Yeah. And it's just amazing. I had
she's
a running
tearing up. Yeah. JR, she's tough as rocks until she gets. Yeah, that's awesome.
I had a running coach. Won't mention any names or anything, but I had a running coach been here for a while. Told someone who's an Ironman, who's done Ironman and everything, and the guy goes, yeah, he goes, you know, today's my light day. I'm trying to lose weight. You know, I'm just going to go hit the gym for a little bit. And the coach told him, well, you're just going to bulk up. To lose weight, you need to go run. And he goes, no, I've been doing Ironmans for 10 years now. I think I know what I'm doing. And the running coach is basically, you know, old school mentality. Yep. Now, nah, blah, 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 blah. And I was like, you got to be kidding me. Come on, man. Because that's another myth. Mm-hmm. You go to the gym, you're going to bulk up.
No,
that is not true.
Runners, I will never look like a CrossFit athlete. My body will not be able to.
Neither will Gary.
And neither will Gary, because Gary loves CrossFit. But no, I mean, my body will not be strong like a bodybuilder. If I do a lot of lifting and I go into that bodybuilding shows, yes, it will. But for me to get strength in my body, I am not going to look like, I will not bulk up.
And because, and folks, if you want to obviously see Jen and Mac and find out what's going on Saturday, great lake workout.
Next Saturday.
Next Saturday?
Yes, sir.
The 16th. Yeah, 16th, not this week. Next Saturday, the 16th, Burney Lake here in San Antonio area, I'll say. At Burney Lake, you're going to go, you check it out, because they're going to do a workout beforehand and then do a swim. So you're actually going to get double the workout at one place.
We're going to do some like open water technique, and then I'm going to talk about strength, and then we're actually going to combo a swim and a like body weight workout at the same time.
There's going to be an education session and then the application. Yeah,
that's going to be awesome.
Right.
Because we always tell people, hey, there's no lanes painted on the bottom of a lake.
I've never seen one,
so you can't find it. And because we had a lady at Tall Texan, I think it was that missed the swim cutoff, and she's like, I've been swimming in the pool every day, and I go, honey. Pool swimming is not lake swimming. And that's the same thing as track running is not road running, is not cross country running.
Nope. All right. Actually, if you keep your head down in a lake, the lines will magically appear. As long as you keep your head. That's what people don't understand.
It's crazy. So we're going to take a quick commercial break. We're going to come back and talk to the coaches. Again, we're going to go into Coach's Corner. We're going to talk hydration and gelling during training runs, because Runner's World just came out and said, hey, deplete your system, run dehydrated, and it'll make you better. And Gary's over here shaking his head, so I'm looking forward to that conversation. We'll be right back. This is Mark with the coaches of all coaches.
Were you aware? Texas has a law that commercial vehicles, when passing a road user such as a cyclist, runner, or walker, must obey a 6 feet distance between said vehicle and the road user. Texas also has a law that all vehicles, when passing a road user, must obey a 3 feet distance. Can you see me now? 3 feet, 6 feet. It's the law. Juicer Heroes provides a menu of the freshest fruit and vegetable juices with varieties of every taste and pricing to fit every budget. A fun, energetic atmosphere that includes unique offerings such as juicers, organic soaps, and scrubs. Joyfully serving healthy, fresh, organic juices and earth-friendly offerings at two incredible locations in San Antonio. 15337 San Pedro Avenue, just south of Willie's Ice House, or 18730 Stone Oak Parkway. Find them online at juicerheroes.com.
No, I can just talk in the car.
So what's going on, folks, is I've got Mandy Heinz on the phone right now. Huge, 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 huge winner, winner. Second place yesterday at the inaugural tour of Utah ladies event. Mandy, Michelle calls you my girlfriend, my other girlfriend, and because it's just amazing. We are so proud of you. Folks, what happens is she was a soccer stud, went to LSU on a scholarship, All-American soccer stud, went into triathlons, said, you know what, I'm fast on a bike, let me go to the bikes, began riding bikes, won a couple events, and moved up to the pro, and then yesterday took it to some of the best in the world and got second to not only the 40-plus time national champion Corinne Rivera from UAC, but Mandy Heights from Guru Cycling. I know you're on your way to the airport, girl. How are you doing?
I'm doing great, and thanks for that. Thanks for that introduction there. It's been humbling, I have to say. I never thought I would see a podium this year, and I've seen a couple, but yesterday's win probably had to feel probably one of the best feelings that I've had in a long time. A lot of the sacrifices showed itself yesterday, and it felt great.
And we knew someone was coming up, because when we did the team presentation and then, obviously, that just started rolling with the Pace Bend, had a great race. And then here comes Houston Grand. You won a $1,000 Preem Sprint against Lauren Stevens, one of the greatest cyclists ever, like yourself. And then you just going on from there. And then now, the big news, we can go ahead and let it out. What are you doing in September for America?
I have gotten the invitation to go to Europe. So I will be wearing red, white, and blue and representing the country as to my best of my ability in a tour in Holland and in Belgium.
Such a stud. So you're such a stud.
No, it's been great. I couldn't have done it without all of my sponsors and all the help along the way and the friends. And it's been great. It's been great. The people I've met along the way have been amazing as well. It's something that you never thought a journey would guide you to. The friendships, the families, the experience of it all.
That's one of those things when you lined up at a race and you've seen, you know, you've watched races on TV or you've seen the magazines and stuff and you're looking over and you're like, holy snikes, that's Allison Powers to my left. Holy snikes, you know, that's Marie Holden over there, you know, directing a team. And I admire these women and now I'm racing against them. That has got to be so surreal for you.
Absolutely. It's a dream that last year I was just following them and saying, oh, I'd love to be there. I'd love to race with them. I'd love to race against them, amongst them. And now I am. And, you know, you actually start having conversations. They actually are real people and very down-to-earth people. So it's a great experience.
Yep, and then when you team up with Tina Pick and her team and do some stuff, it's amazing. And I like I said, I'm tickle pink, and I cannot, which is obviously the colors of Guru Cycling, but I cannot be more proud of you, and I can't wait to kidnap you and bring you to San Antonio for a while.
Yes, I'm going to come down there so we can do some motor pacing.
There you go. We've already got it. We've got it set up too. So, Mandy, I know you're on the way to the airport, and give me a call later when you finally get home.
I will, and thank you guys for everything and all the support. Cheers from abroad.
Yep, Hot Wheels Racing. Follow them on Twitter at Hot Wheels Race and find out what's going on next. Of course, congratulations, Mandy. We'll talk to you soon.
Thank you. All right, take care.
Bye-bye. Bye. So, of course, this is Mark from I Speak Freedom. We're not going to do any commercials. We're going right into the coaches. I'm going to turn their mics back on as they all been talking amongst themselves. What happened was I had Mandy Heintz from Guru's professional cycling team on the phone. She was a beginning cyclist 2 years ago. Now she's pro, and now she's on the national team. That's how fast. She was an Ironman triathlete and said, yeah, I'm going to try this bike racing thing for a while. And now she's on the national team and heading out to it. So what's going on is we're going to get into we're going to do this really quick, though. Hydration and gelling, because, Gary, we talked about it before we went to the commercial. And Runner's World saying you really don't need to hydrate. Deplete your system. And then once you hydrate with cold water, you're going to do performance is going to go through the chain.
I'm going to make this very, very simple and clear.
Go for it, Gary.
Someone has asked.
Oh, wait. Before, does everybody know that are listening now, this is Gary Brimmer of GaryBrimmer.com. Been coaching for years, been on the Army running team. Has been there, done that. This is not some guy I just picked up off the street that was cutting the grass or something. Say, come in and talk. Gary knows his shit. I'll tell you that right now. So go ahead, Gary.
If you want to get better at running, and this is good, I'm going to come back around to this question. You run more. And when it hurts,
you keep running.
You keep running. And do that every day. Get a routine going. But for goodness sake, whatever you do, never, ever, ever take anything you read in Runner's World as good information. It is the most worthless rag out there. It has lost its place within our industry. It has absolutely lost its place. If you want to sign up for 1 year and they recycle the same garbage, the same run your fastest 5K on 1 day a week running, finish a marathon without ever having to do long runs.
3 days a week.
It is ridiculous. And for them to say you should dehydrate yourself is so irresponsible. It's asinine. I cannot believe that anybody would recommend you dehydrate yourself. It's one thing to carbohydrate deplete yourself. That's a whole nother question. Mm-hmm. But fluid intake for humans, period, is so important for wellness and health.
Well, I was telling Gary that as human beings, we have the worst thirst mechanism. I mean, we learned that in basic exercise phys. You know, and when we say we're thirsty, it's too late.
And I just I can't believe that they would suggest that you can do anything slightly dehydrated. It's ridiculous.
And my thing on that is too, and you can kind of add to either one of you guys, but you know, if you don't have water in your system, your blood isn't, your stroke volume is gone.
Yes.
Your muscles doesn't have the ability to pull in the fuel into the cells for energy. I mean, that makes no sense. You're not moving oxygen yet.
I'm sure at some point you thicken the blood. Now it starts getting cardio. It's a cardiovascular danger.
Because your heart's got to be harder.
Your heart has to work harder to pump this sludge through your body. That's ridiculous.
And I think he's done.
I freaking love Gary Brimmer. I'll tell you that right now. But no, there's the article. You can take that with you and read it and then and bring it back. But, of course, you know, we talk about that. And there's folks that when I've run marathons with groups of runners, they're like, oh, you know, ladies are like, I've got to take my gel. Every 15 minutes I'm supposed to take this gel. And I'm going, Man, you can't digest gel in 15 minutes. How are you taking gel every 15 minutes in a marathon?
Maybe a quarter of a gel packet every 15, I would think, but not a full one.
Or how about no gels in a marathon or half marathon?
And do you can?
I was about to say that because I was given, I just did an event in Austin, and they get me, I don't even know what stuff's called,
Vega Sport,
yep. And it's from Canada, and it's plant-based, and it's all natural and everything like that, and that's why I sent it to you guys saying, hey, they give me Vega Sport. UCAN, I know all three of you guys are huge on Generation UCAN.
Well, they're ambassadors, so give them props.
I know that. Yeah. I know that. But you're on it as well. So it's one of those things like, you know, what we always see is that marathons or Ironmans or whatever, you see these products come out and go, oh, I want to try that. But your system's not ready for that. Stay with what you know. So one of those things like Generation UCAN, we know. We know it's proven, hands down, from elite down to the couch runners. We know that. When Vegas Board or somebody else comes out, how much trust can you give that product?
Well, I would tell you that the sport, pendulums are swinging back and forth within our sport, within running, within any endurance sport. You saw that with shoe wear or, you know, the types of shoe that we're putting on our feet. You know, when that half fiction, half truth book came out called Born to Run. They talked about, and all of a sudden everyone's wearing
the. Gary's on a roll today.
I was ready to go run through Death Valley after reading that book, man.
It was a very good, entertaining book, but there were some half truths in it.
Right.
Even though the pendulum swung immediately to one side with minimalism, and people were wearing very, very minimal shoes. Whether it be the Vibrams, who are now paying $90 to anybody that applies for a refund. You know, a bunch of shoe companies went very, very minimal. The pendulum swung too far. The good thing about that is what it is. We come somewhere in the middle now. We realize runners don't need to be absolutely over control with their shoes.
Right.
So nutrition has done the same thing. We went to where we had nothing. My first couple of marathons, you drank what was on the course, and usually it was water. That's why people really hit the wall. And then in about 94, Gatorade came out with Reload, and there was another one called Squeezy. And it was high corn syrup fructose gels. And it was one of the first things that we had to put in our system, and it was great. They do work. But the problem is people started using them more and more, and they started realizing they're having problems with GI distress. And you saw it go into some weight loss issues, people not losing weight, what have you. Where the pendulum has now swung with sports nutrition is we're getting away from the high carb, high corn syrup, high corn syrup fructose type products, and we're going to more plant based, more. We're trying to get a stable blood sugar as opposed to peaks and valleys. That's why someone has to take the gels on a very, very rapid succession, whether it's 30 to 45 minutes, which is about normal. You got products out there. UCAN is not the only superstarch product. Now, there's another product that says it's the superstarch. It's a rice-based product where they have done some heat moisture process with it to make the product. They've changed the comp. They've changed the chemical makeup of the the carbohydrate. Instead of being a simple carbohydrate, it's a complex carbohydrate, which digests quicker. And so that's where sports nutrition is going. I was reading on the Vegas, I don't know much about it, but we were reading the nutrition information on it. It's a lower sugar, more protein type product. The funny thing is 25, 30 years ago, PR Bar told everyone to stay higher protein, moderate carb, moderate lower fat. And endurance runners, we thought they were silly because we need to carb load. And they were right all along. So.
And I'm a high protein, high fat, low carb eater.
Right. But you have to have the carbs in order to function. There was a diet. I can't remember what the diet was.
Atkins.
No carbs. Don't, you know, keep carbs out. And I'm going, if you're an athlete, even a 5K runner or what have you, you've got to have carbs in order to move. I mean,
there are some people that do really well on the Atkins type diet. Dr. Tim Noakes is a very, very big proponent of low carb, low carb, high protein, moderate fat. He even says higher fat. And there are some health benefits to bringing down your carb intake. The problem is carbs are your brain fuel. And those of us that have ever gotten low or bonked or come in from a hard workout, long workout, and your daughter, your granddaughter, your wife, your husband, whatever, says, hey, how'd the run go? And you curse them out because you have low emotional intelligence. Right. That's because the carbohydrate food into our brain is gone. That's what happens when people get away from, they start going low carb. People cut out sugar for the first time and they do like a paleo type diet, which is not a low carb. I think people think paleo is a low carb. It's not. It's a clean carb. But the first thing they do is they cut out sugar. We start cutting out all the sugar from our brain. We tend to get a little irritable. So that's the problem with not having, for going no carb, is you will be irritable. A friend of mine talked to me on the phone a couple weeks ago, a former All-American steeplechase runner, and he's coming close to 40 and he's gaining weight, and he said he's going no carb. And I gave him my cautionary tale about no carbs, and he goes, wow, that's crazy. I was at a convention last week and I couldn't recall the word avalanche. I couldn't remember the name.
And because he wasn't
feeding his brain. He was, so his cognitive reasoning was, he was just losing. And he said, that makes sense now. And he was a little grumpy with the family. So that's the thing about, if you go a little lower carb, you can still eat carbs, but you need to lower the carbs.
Well, when I get my carbs in, if I'm grumpy, Michelle, first question Michelle said,
have you eaten?
No. Did you go run today? Did you work out today? I'm like, no. Well, stop being a B and go do something. Okay.
Yeah.
You know, that kind of thing.
But here's the thing, though. When we talk about carbohydrates, it's not your pastas, breads, grains, and all that stuff. I mean, that's the gluten stuff. But when I think of carbs in my world, I think of fruits, vegetables. Sweet potatoes, squash, quinoa, rice. You know, like I do have to add a little bit of quinoa and rice when I get closer to my heavy training. But yeah, when we say carbs, don't just assume it's a donut, you know, or it's a Gatorade or pasta. Yeah.
When you guys say carbs, I think of pizza.
Yeah.
Exactly.
No, because that's huge.
So a lot of people think carbs is, you know, your basic grains and all that stuff, and it's not. That's in fruits and vegetables as well.
So Generation UCAN, like I said, all three of you guys are on it. I've never had any. Gary hasn't brought me samples or anything, but I always throw Gary under the bus. But it's one of those things that of course, Meb won Boston, Generation UCAN athlete. So everybody's like, oh, you know, Meb's on it. I want to go for it. However, it's been around for a while before, and Meb was one of the first guys on it.
5 years.
Before it was even marketed or anything like that. So one of those things, folks, is you can get Generation UCAN, obviously at Lifetime Gym, they have it. Mm-hmm. I keep seeing it every time I'm up there. And you can get it at your local running store.
Yeah, Solars carries it here in San Antonio, as does We Run San Antonio.
Yeah. Yeah.
Edgar was the first person to bring it into the specialty store We Run San Antonio. And just on another note on Generation UCAN, at Solars in Helotes, Varen from UCAN is in town. He's coming tonight. In today at 6 p.m. We're having an information talk on Generation UCAN. We'll have some samples to give out. So
tomorrow
night,
Bart Childress. Yeah. Valley Wampus is doing a 10K run, and I'll be out there helping Varen. Sweet.
Yeah, so if you want to know the information, that's what I was going to get to next. If you want to know the information about Generation UCAN, obviously you can Google it, look at it online and everything, but if you want to talk to the folks that know, obviously you need to get a hold of you three.
And if anyone wants, I can tell you that it works, and I can tell you how it works. I'm okay at telling you why it works, but Varen, the folks from UCAN, these guys are amazing. They're great people. Come out to Solars tonight, and the Solars in Helotes. Outside the loop, 6 p.m.
Yeah, it's Old Town Helotes.
He's having a session.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah. He gives a great talk.
What time is that talk?
6 p.m.
6 p.m., okay.
Yep, 6 p.m.
That's amazing because, of course, folks, like I said, a lot of folks who are getting ready for Rock and Roll Marathon, per se, getting ready for the fall races that are coming up, fall marathons, Ironmans and stuff, because obviously Ironman Panama City is coming. Folks are like, I want to try, like Jen over there, I want to try something that you know, get me over that edge, get me to that top. Generation UCAN, like I said, I've researched it, I've looked at it and everything like that. I'm going, you know what, that's going to help me on my run that I'm going to do. And it's one of those things like, I want it in my system now, and I don't want to try it on event day.
And here's the thing about Generation U, Ken. Here's what always gets people's attention. You can run for 3 hours and never take a gel. 3 hours.
He's exactly right. Yeah. I did 3 weeks ago. I was out training with – I've got a couple Arizona guys coming up, training them, and I ran with them. And I did UCAN that day, and I needed absolutely nothing the entire
time.
Water
for hydration.
No, I just – and we had a five-hour bike the next day, right? And I needed absolutely nothing. The next weekend, we had more or less same workout, and I was like, I'm just going to test it out. And I didn't take any UCAN with me. And on the run, I was
you're hurting.
I was hurt. And we ran there in Bernie. And I mean, I hated doing it, but I literally was having to. By the time we were 2 hours in or so, I was having to stop at corner stores every few miles to get a Mountain Dew just to carry me through.
Yeah, wow.
I mean, it was night and day.
But the great thing is you figure that out during training.
That's right. And I wanted to test it so yeah. I could see yeah. what the difference yeah. was. And I will never again train without UCAN because it's. I'm convinced.
Man, that's last testimony
weekend,
right there.
Yeah, big time. Last weekend, I took it a step further. I actually did a UCAN pack before a three-hour bike just to see how I would do just on one. And I got – it was about – you know, it was a three-hour bike. And I was okay, pretty good all the way through. And I went pretty hard. And the last 3 or 4 miles, shot. I had nothing left.
Double up your serving.
And that's where he was testing the system. He was like, okay, what is comfortable with and what I'm not comfortable with, like you said – that training is perfect. Don't do it on race day. Don't even and you guys are the coaches, you're the pros. I wouldn't even say don't even do it race week. Don't even go, okay, I'm gonna try this race week because your system's gonna be so out of whack.
Absolutely.
You start about 3 months before your A race.
Yep. Well, and that was my issue, and I reached out to Gary last year for Ironman Florida because I was having so many GI issues and I kept reading about Generation UCAN. I was like, I need to change something now. And I was 6 weeks out from Ironman Florida. I would not recommend that. But it was just me trying to figure it out with the Generation UCAN. And I kept adding, like, I added almond butter at one point. I added a little bit of fat. And then just it wasn't, like, the best. But you just have to try. I mean, and so then when I went into New Orleans this year and Coeur d'Alene, I was spot on with my Generation UCAN. And figured it out.
Nutrition's that other element of racing that a lot of folks are like, I'll have a bagel in the morning and then I'll go do it. I'll be fine. No.
Yeah.
You don't see that. So they've got to get that dialed in. Of course, again, tonight, 6 o'clock, try Solaire up in Helotes. Go to the store. It's an Old Town Helotes outside 1604, head of Bandana Road. It's going to be on your left. It's right there by across the street from Floor Store. Just go up there. You can Google it, solarsports.com. Find out more information on how to get there. Again, tonight at 6 o'clock, find out more information about Generation UCAN. I think I'm going to leave the kids here in front of the TV, the babysitter, and head up there myself. I'm just kidding. I can't do that. But it's incredible. So we're going to do real quick. We got three questions I know you guys have that you need to answer. And I've actually, if you don't have any, I've got some questions for you. But again, what three questions do you have, Mac?
I don't have any.
I got one for you.
Oh, goodness.
Mac, what makes a good swimmer?
Patience.
Patience?
That's the first thing that comes to mind. People, we're human beings. We want results too fast. Swimming is too technical.
There's not an app for that?
No, there's not. There is. It's called Coach Mac Williams every Wednesday night. From 7 to 8 o'clock.
That was good.
Absolutely.
That was
there
good.
Is an app for that.
And I was about to ask you, how can I improve what you just answered right there? So,
what, by coming to see me every Wednesday night? Yeah, how can you improve? Yeah.
Or on Saturday, August 16th, I'll tell you
now.
Yep. But does different strokes improve your performance?
Yes.
Like, should you, if you're, you know, does freestyle different from backstroke, from doggy paddle? I mean, does different strokes improve your performance overall?
Two things on this. One is different strokes, and again, I don't have the time to be able to train everyone who comes to me on all the strokes because they just want to do their Ironman. They want to get through their half.
Right.
But the thing is, yes, because one, you're developing different muscle groups, and two, you get a better feel for the water. So if you have the ability to swim an IM as part of your workout, absolutely do it.
Because even Michael Phelps and those guys are doing different strokes. They're not just doing one –
Yeah, I mean, yeah, absolutely. I mean, you've got your A stroke and you got your B stroke, and that's what you're going to focus on in your races as from competitive swim aspect of things, right? But you know, if you're an Ironman athlete and you have a swim program that and you have the ability to do all the strokes, sign up for that program. Because
Mac
you
Williams,
will get a better
Wednesday
feel
night.
For the water. Absolutely.
SanAntonioTriathlete.com.
I will get
find
you
more info. Jen, what's your three questions? If you don't, I have them.
I have two questions.
There you go.
What do you wear for an Ironman, and where do you place strength in your triathlon training?
Oh,
that's good.
Number two is that's going to be long-winded, but number one, what do you wear for your Ironman?
Little as
if
possible.
If it's your first Ironman, change. So wear a swimsuit and your wetsuit if you want. Go change, drop your doors, put on your cycling shorts, put on a cycling jersey.
Because
you're
in a tent.
You're in a tent.
Yeah.
So you could drop your doors. And then if you want to get out of your, I suggest you get out of your cycling shorts, throw on some running shorts. Or if you feel like you need to wear a little bit of compression, a little bit smaller shorts, go with a thinner pad. So if it's your first Ironman, change out of it.
So you're saying go from the biking shorts because of the thicker pad? For the distance on the bike that helps them with the booty
yeah,
a little bit. Is that
long.
What you're
okay?
It absorbs sweat. So you're running in sweat for 26.2 miles that has been sitting there.
For the padding. Oh, yeah. I would not suggest running in cycling shorts.
No.
Not at all.
No.
Change.
Yeah. So change. So that's the one question. And then where do you place strength into triathlon training? It's all about periodization with your race. So you're not going to do as much strength training closer to your race. You're going to do that more of your off season, but you are still going to do it throughout that season. You know, it's the first one to go if you're exhausted, if you're tired, if you're fatigued, if your HRV is
yes.
totally low, if your heart rate's down, you know, high, that's the first thing to go. So the strength training is all about building strong, heavy off season, you know, base phase. And then going into your build phase is when you pull back because now you need to go specific of your swim, bike, and run.
Nice.
Very good.
I had a question someone asked me. What would help a runner gain strength and not lose speed in strength training? Yeah.
More intensity of the strength training then.
Yeah.
Low weight, high reps. Thing is
high weight, low reps.
Yeah. High weight, low reps. Oh,
yeah,
really?
More explosive.
Okay.
So yep. powerful, explosive.
More powerful, explosive stuff.
Like, you know, cleans are great, but a lot of people aren't comfortable with that. But even explosive box jumps, jumping squats.
Yep.
Not with weight on the back, but jumping air squats.
Yeah. Okay.
Be more explosive. Yeah. I'm all about low rep, high weight. Yeah.
Of course, jenrulon.com. We'll find out more information. Gary, I know you got three questions, and I even have three questions for you. Go for it.
So I'm going to piggyback on her strength one because that was one of my questions. It was a combined question. Should we do two-a-days and cross-training, weight training when in the week? So two-a-days real quick. I do not recommend two-a-days for anybody who's not running 70 to 80 miles a week. On singles, on one-a-day workouts. There's no reason because there's more benefit to going out and run 1 6-mile run than 2 4-mile runs. Mm. So just go out and run 8 miles. If you want 8 miles, go out and run 8 miles or just run 6 miles. And then the other thing was cross-train. When do we do it? I have my runners do their, whether they swim, whether they want to cycle, whether they want to lift, whether they want to do yoga, whether they want to do a boot camp, whether they want to do CrossFit. I do have some that I can't get through to them. We do that
on
our...
I
want to
see Gary flip a tire.
No.
So don't say the words runner's world, CrossFit, or minimalist shoes around Gary. You're good.
Yeah, exactly.
Born to Run. That's the three.
That's right.
Cross, any of the extra stuff you're going to do needs to be done on your hard day. On your days that you're doing speed... tempo and long. If you're gonna do anything extra, do it on that day. Don't do it on your recovery day. Your recovery day, your rest day, your easy go out and run and talk all day long while you're doing your run is a day to recover. Mm-hmm. You want your body to rest in between because what's more important is the next workout. You have to be recovered to have a quality workout in the next workout. And like Jen said, if you find you're not doing the workouts very well, drop the cross training. Drop one.
Ooh.
Drop the cross training for a week or two until your body recovers into it.
So that's,
you got to have one training focus. You can't have two.
Exactly.
Right. Well,
and I have some, so I think some people can, they have so much energy and they want to do more stuff. And it's, and for my weightlifting, I'm more of the higher rep, low weights, no more than 70% of your maximum lift. That's what I do. But I'm more of a strength cardiovascular. If you don't have, I don't care how fast you are, if you're not with my guys at the end of the race to use your speed, my guys are going to just pound you into the ground during, over the race. That's just the way I've coached for years.
You're just a mean guy.
the other one was, do you, what's the longest run you need to do for a marathon? And I think that if you're if you're faster than about 3:30, you can go up 3:30 or faster, you can do up to 20 miles. Notice I didn't say how long, because all my runners get a pace, and they know they need to run their longer than within a certain pace.
So you're talking mileage, not time?
Mileage, not time.
Okay.
Now, if you are slower than that, if you're a 3:30 to a 4-hour marathoner, now I'm not going to have you run probably much more than 16 miles.
Yep.
No kidding.
But you're going to go 8 miles on Friday, maybe 10 miles on Saturday, 16 miles on Sunday. So in a 36-hour period, you've done a good bulk of running. Because at some point in time, you're out there, and you're out on the roads in this heat, and you're out doing your long runs, 3 hours and 30 to 4 hours for some of your training runs. Now you're just beating the body down, and you're not having enough time to come right back down. It's a recovery thing. Recover for your next workout. Because all of my runners, whether they're 4-hour marathoners or Olympic trials qualifiers, all of my marathoners all do speed, tempo, long runs. All of them.
Let me ask you this: how do you train them to metabolize beyond 16 miles?
It just works.
They just
it
have does. To deal
it
with it.
It just happens.
Really? Okay.
Yeah.
There's an article a long time ago that I found that
in Runner's World.
In Runner's World, no. Maybe Inside Triathlon. No, I don't know. But it was saying that. With triathletes, I generally don't have my triathletes go more than 2 hours and 30 minutes.
Right.
For Ironman training. And people are like, what? Don't I need to go more than that? And I'm like, if you want to and trash your body, sure. Yep. But you really don't need to. So if you're doing a 6-hour bike on Friday, and then you have a day off or swim on Saturday, and then a long run, there's no reason that your body needs to go more than 2 hours and 30.
Right.
Sorry, I totally interrupted.
You're absolutely fine. The other questions, I'll take your questions.
I got a question. Is high mileage better? Because you read about Dina Castor and all these elite runners and everything are running 110 to 130 miles a week.
I would tell you that people who train for marathons and half marathons don't run enough miles. They just don't.
Can the body handle it if they were to put it? Okay.
Yes. More. I think people can handle more mileage than what they think they can handle.
As long as they stay healthy.
You got to stay healthy. Yeah. That is very, very key to being healthy. You have to be able to help, and there comes in the ancillary work, whether it's core work and all that stuff. You have to be able to do that. But
proper shoes, all that.
Every one of my top high school runners and all of my age groupers that I have, everyone that I have, I mean, I've had two girls that were really, really good before I started coaching them, two of my Olympic trials qualifiers. I just didn't have to crash the car with them. That was it. It was convincing them that they didn't need to be, that what they were doing was good enough. But everybody else that I've turned from either a runner no one ever heard about to what is so-and-so doing,
right,
all we've done is slowly built the mileage up. And now when I say high mileage, very few people can handle or need to run more than about 90 miles a week. That's my top runners. Most of your age groupers can handle 60 to 70 miles a week, and they don't think they can, but they can. And that's high mileage for a lot of people.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
very, very high mileage for a lot of people. But you can handle it. You can. You can't start tomorrow and go out and start running 70 miles a week.
Right.
But yes.
You got to build up.
Yeah. I believe in high mileage.
No, and that's where, I mean, you're so right. I mean, when I was training for my 223-mile run, and I was up to 15, 20 miles a day before I got injured, and that was on my own fault. That was nobody else's fault that I got injured. It was my own stupidity. But it was one of those things, like when I came back, and I came back this week is my first training week back since last year. So it's like my mind is telling me go, and I'm going, no. I'm walking the hills, running the flat, then downhills. As soon as I feel an incline, up, I'm walking, because I'm not going to push myself to hurt, because I want to make it to March. You know
right.
what I mean?
Right.
So it's one of those things that you – when you talk about going to digging deep and everything, it's like, I know I can do it, but I'm going, no, I just came back from an injury. I don't want to push myself and get re-injured and go, crap, this sucks.
And when you come back from an injury, at some point, and it's usually about 6 to 8 weeks into the comeback, there you have to make a decision. You have to be in a workout, and you have to make a decision to take a chance and push through to the next level. I went from being a very, very good marathoner. At one point, thought I could qualify for the Olympic trials. In 2001, I was rock solid fit. I mean, I was. We were thinking I was going to run 225 on an average day, and I ruptured two discs in my lower back, and I became a 2-hour and 45-minute marathoner overnight. When I came back, I was on 8 weeks bed rest. When I finally came back, started running. I was overweight, out of shape, almost. And I was running with the girls within our group. That's who I was running with. And I remember doing workouts with our whole running team out in Hawaii. And there was a workout where the week before we were doing 400s. And what I would do is start with the guys. I finally started running with the guys. And I would pull them through the first 150 and then let them kind of come on by me and then kind of pull me around.
Right.
The next week we had mile repeats, and it was probably about the third mile repeat. I made a conscious decision that I needed to either just blow my hamstrings out on the track somewhere and just find out if I could get back and run hard. And I ran a very, very solid last. I was running about 5:10s, but I needed to be under 5. And I nailed the last two. And I remember it was at that moment I realized, okay, I'm back from this injury. So at some point in an injury comeback, make sure you're healthy, make sure things are okay, and you got to go, ooh, do I want to take this risk and take the next step, or do I really feel something going on in my hamstring or in my back, or is it in my head? And you have to make that decision to test it.
Well, they always say the first mile is the hardest because your body's like, no, come on, don't do this, go back and lay down. I think
getting out the door can be the hardest.
Yeah. Especially now, and people are like, obviously Ironman's coming up, and people are going out there going, ooh, it's hot, I don't want to go out and get the mileage in. Or even the marathon's coming up. You've got to train for rock and roll in the heat. I got a real quick question for you, for all three of you guys. It's a $1 billion industry. You can't go through a magazine, a page without seeing it. Supplements, how important are they to your training and to your racing?
Vitamins or just?
Yeah, vitamins.
I got you.
Go ahead.
You know, I had text Jen a few weeks ago about Branch Chain. And I dabbled in them a few years ago and didn't really know why I needed to take it, but I did a little bit of research, talked to some folks, I got some info from JR and or General Line and
.com.
Yeah, .com. And and I've taken those over the last several weeks.
Just let you know real quick, when she finishes a race, I'm just going to go GeneralLine.com. I'm not going to say this is General Line, like General Line, like GaryBremer.com, SanAntonioTriathlete.com. Just let you know. Go ahead.
It's helped a lot with my recovery. I'm taking Branch Chains at nights before I go to sleep. And I was up to, I was running 45, 50 miles up for a few weeks ago. And I just got to a point where I was, my legs were hurting. I feel like I was recovering well enough, and I eat pretty well. And those Branch Chains have really helped quite a bit. I'll do some protein before at night, and then I'll do those Branch Chains before I go to sleep to kind of give my body something to use to recover with. And it helps. So if there's one thing for endurance that goes, or you got a lot of high intensity training going, or really if you're just age group or weekend warrior, and you want to recover well, I definitely suggest getting that into your budget if you can do it.
Yeah. I sometimes have a hard time taking my supplements, but I know how important they are because I know the body can't produce everything that, through food.
Cause you're depleting a lot.
You're depleting a lot. So I do, and I do a multivitamin. I don't do like the over the counter stuff. I buy specific the stuff from Charles Poliquin. That's,
you mean the little orange bottles at HEB?
I don't buy the gummy vitamins.
Okay, all right.
Yeah,
all right.
That is right. Not, you know. Take so that one, yeah, out. I do a multivitamin. I do fish oil. I do magnesium in the evening because that helps me sleep. And I do branched chain amino acids, and then I generally do some type of protein powder after because I want to get that I want to get that recovery in me ASAP. Mm-hmm.
Right.
Because I know sometimes I'll be like, oh, I'll just eat later. Hour goes by, hour and a half go by. Like, you need that food or you need that recovery.
Yeah, when your body's, I know you guys know this, but when your body's telling you you've got to eat,
it's too late.
It's too late. It's already deteriorating.
It's called hangry.
And make sure it's liquid nutrition right after your workout.
Yeah, and we talked about that with Simon with the Fitness Kitchen. Yeah. Obviously, Suzanne from Powerhouse Bakery. We've talked about that. Is when you're crashing, you're crashing. And it's one of those things like, oh, I've got to eat right now. I've got to eat right now. You should never get to that point.
Right.
No.
Mm-hmm. I do a nutritional supplement. We were talking about it. The company out of Vista, California called BioPharma, and they have the omegas and
really good stuff.
And it's really, really good stuff. It's not cheap.
None of this is on the banned list, right?
No. All of a product that I take, I make sure that it's been cleared through WADA. I make sure that that's who that the company has gone and done their research, and they have the seal of approval on their product. But I'm a big fan of I get my greens, I get my reds, I get my omegas, I get my fish oils, and I've had it's a vegan based product, and it's helped me regulate blood glucose levels. It helps me with my weight and everything. So and I'm a big fan. I don't go into GNC and buy over the counter stuff. If I'm gonna take the time and buy some stuff, I'm gonna put the right stuff in my body and make sure it's clean.
I tell you what, folks, you've got to, and if you haven't, and if you listen to anything I say, I mean, a lot of the times it's a lot of bullshit, but I'm telling you right now, you've got to, especially at a race. I'll have you qualifying for Boston when you're running a 5K. It's one of those things. But if you really want to excel your performance, just make yourself better. Your performance better. You're running, you're cycling, you're swimming, whatever it be. You've got to get a hold of these coaches because, you know, they're taking the time to come in here. I'm not even paying them. I'm paying them in water. But, you know, GaryBrimmer.com, GenRelon.com, SanAntonioTriathlete.com. Again, pick their brains. You got to get a hold of them and say, hey, you know, I heard you on that program, and I need to know what I can do because – they've been there, done that. It's not one of these things, like I said, I mean, you hear it all the time. You see it on TV. You see it in magazines. Guys are like, oh, I ran 3 marathons. I know what I'm talking about. Nothing against those folks. I'll say that right now. There are some good coaches out there that have run 2 or 3 marathons. However, for the folks that have been there year in, year out, know what they're talking about. These are the 3, especially here in Texas. And I always tell people, they're like, oh, I'm going to go to Austin. Forget Austin. San Antonio has got the people you need to talk about. And because, you know, you talk about it, Mac and I talked about that at the beginning of the year. Oh, there's triathlon camps in Austin. Why are there not any triathlon camps in San Antonio? We've got Bernie Lake. We've got Ironman here. We've got runners like Gary puts on that camp, and he puts on the number one running camp in Texas here in San Antonio because he has people that have qualified for Texas relays. He's had state champions and everything. It's one of those things you've got to get a hold of these folks and go, what do I need to do? Because I know when I'm getting into series in my training, these are the 3 folks I'm going to talk to. And I know Olympians. I know folks that'll take me wherever I need to go. But these are the 3 that I trust emphatically. So, again, these are the coaches. And I'm going to talk to Gary because Jen's got to take a call real quick. Gary and Mac, is there a better time to train? Is there day, night, afternoon? When is the best time to train?
I think the best time is to train is all personal. Mm-hmm. I've trained at all times. I used to be an afternoon guy. I find personally that I like getting it done first thing in the morning, but everybody's schedule is different and you have to figure out what works best for your schedule. What's going to keep you motivated to get the workout done. I think if you're a person who worries about workouts, you may not want to be a morning person because you never get to sleep thinking about the next day's workout. But I think what's more important, not just the time that you're doing the workout, but do you have someone to do the workout with? And not necessarily a coach, because coaches are great. I think you have to have a coach. If you want to become better at a sport, a coach is very, very important. But I'm talking more about your training partners, because with training partners, there's a little bit of accountability of, yep, I have to be there. Mm-hmm. Because so-and-so and so-and-so are waiting for me, and they expect me to be there to help with the workout.
See, I don't have any training partners where I am because, you know, I'm retired, so I'm at home. Once I put the kids in Lifetime Gym or whatever, I got 2 hours to get my run in. I mean, obviously, I can swim, which I did the other day. They got a great pool there, so I did 400 meters. Took a lot of what your lessons were with Michelle, and I was like, okay, I've done triathlons, but let me see what Mac is doing. And I'm like, man, this is hard. It was harder than what I've ever done. But it's one of those things, like my workouts – or during the day, especially when school starts, I have, Gary, you're going to love this, from 7:30 in the morning till 3 in the afternoon to do nothing but
train.
Oh,
my gosh.
I've got 8 awesome. Hours of commitment to just go run, cycle, whatever.
Uh-oh.
Mac what Mark is telling us. We need to get him the shirt that says no excuse.
Oh, nice. Suck it up, cupcake.
Let you know, because you were talking about having a training partner.
That's right.
In this book, besides what I wrote in today, but in this book has Michelle and I's weights and measurements. Every Monday we weight and measure. And she looks in there and sees what my notes were that day, like training days, to see if I did anything. And then she'll come out and go, oh, you didn't do anything today? No. Go.
Get your butt out
there. Have no excuse.
I have no excuse. Especially I got 8 hours when school starts to go.
No excuse.
Yep.
I think for me, you know, I'm a mirror, same thing. He says, for training, it's so mental. You got to, when I say mental, I mean, you got to be healthy mentally. And so whenever it's comfortable for you to go train, do it. You know, I'm an early morning guy like he is. You know, if I'm training in the afternoon, I'm grumpy because I hate training in the afternoon.
Oh, so I love it. I love it in the heat.
And I love getting up early when the sun's coming up, man. It's just you and God. You know what I mean? And you just get up there and you just do your thing and just have a blast running. I love running in the morning because I can get more mileage in running in the morning through the week, and then I focus on my bike and swimming in the afternoons.
Yeah, but you're going back to work here in a week or two soon, so your training is going to be changing.
Yeah, I should still be able to get my runs in fairly early because I'm accustomed to running in the dark. In Tennessee, where I'm from, man, sun's up by 5:30, 6:00.
Oh.
You know what I mean? So I was always used to running when it's light outside. Yeah. Getting here, it's pitch dark. So that was a big adjustment for me. But, you know, same thing he says. You know, whenever it's comfortable, get out there and do it. You know, one thing some folks may want to get into, I've heard, you know, during the summer is a good time to do a lot of good training because, you know, we chatted briefly about it before the thing started was, you know, during the summer it promotes increase of capillary beds to the muscles with the heat. So, you know, training in the summer is a good deal because it could increase blood flow to the muscles. And then when you're running and competing in the fall and winter, you're running faster. You can run more efficiently that way.
But the big thing about it, folks, is get out there.
Yes. And or just get out there and do it.
Because you will – there's a statistic, I think it's like 62% or something like that, that you will feel better that you got out there and did something.
Yep. Sure.
So absolutely. Get out there and do it. Obviously, like I said, GaryBrimmer.com, JenRulon.com, SanAntonioTriathlete.com. Mac puts on an incredible swim training on Wednesday nights at UTSA. Is that going to continue on, or when does that stop?
You mean the Wednesday night meets?
Yeah.
It's indefinite.
Sweet. I love it. I love it. And obviously, Gary is a big CrossFit fan and stuff like that. But it's one of those things, again, folks, we put on this show for you. We don't get paid for this. This is all for you. And we want you to get yourself better. So the way to do it, obviously, is get a hold of those three folks, GaryBrimmer.com, JenRulon.com, and, of course, SanAntonioTriathlete.com. My name is Mark from iSpeakFree.net. The next thing I will be doing is I will be at – I don't know what I'll be at. I'll be at a race. No.
Tonight.
Solar tonight.
That's right. Solar Sports tonight. But of course, also, let you know what's going on. Let me find it here. We run San Antonio. We were talking about that place on Sunday. They're going to be at Lululemon Athletic Shops in La Caterra, hosting clinics on proper running mechanics, nutrition, injury prevention, all that good stuff. They're going to have some local events and other prize giveaways, as well as we know that we are going to be giving away a Dragon's Den half entry. It's a half marathon or a relay or a 2 mile that we're going to give away as well. I mean, it's one of those things, folks. Get out there, have fun. Thanks for listening. If you have any questions for the coaches, get a hold of them or just email me at info@ispeakforyou.net, and we'll get it to the coaches. There is no show next week. We're going to be out training, so nice. We're going to do it in 2 weeks. And again, for a Rock and Roll Marathon, if you need an enter code to get into that thing, the enter code is AM Short. That's AM Short. It's not any derogatory thing against short people, but that's the code, AM Short, and that gets you $20 off for the San Antonio Rock and Roll Marathon on checkout. And again, the Rock and Roll Marathon, big day for me, December 7th. Of course, it's Pearl Harbor, being a retired Navy. That is going to be very emotional for me, and it's also emotional because John Bingham is retiring from announcing at Rock and Roll San Antonio. So that is going to be a big weekend for my good friend John. He's been my mentor for the last 5 years, and we're looking forward to having a big party with him. And, of course, find out more information about San Antonio Marathon, of course, at ispeakforyou.net. Coaches, thanks for y'all for coming in.
Thank you.
Gary, you're on a roll today.
I'm on a roll today. I was in a good mood, too. It's a good thing I wasn't in a pissy mood.
I know. Gary's in a pissy mood.
Mentioned the competitor, and he was pissed.
I was talking about the running magazine. But now, folks, again, thanks for listening. God bless. Take care. Have a great weekend. And as always, make sure you hydrate, Hydrate. Hydrate.
Peace.
Peace. We'll talk to you later.
So I've got them doing strength.